I imagined that it would be somewhere where I would be learning to do sewing and craft of different sorts and maybe schooling.
I didn't know about really what went on behind there, the walls of Parramatta, until I got there. I'd heard rumours, you know, you always hear rumours, but you don't really know what to expect until you get there.
The bashings and everything, I thought, they wouldn't be doing that, you know? Like, they've got to care for you. And that wasn't to be. That wasn't to be.
My first day on arrival, I was just full of fear because people tell you, oh, Parramatta's bad, it's terrible. So when I arrived, I just slid out of my sandals and I ran. And of course, I didn't know where I was running to. From day one, because I absconded, because I ran, that's a charge. That's a bad charge. And so you're treated like as if you're a criminal. And you're just a child. I mean, I ran because I was scared, not because I was a criminal, because I was scared stiff of what was beyond that wall.
There was different times you got allocated different duties on a punishment level, scrubbing them on my hands and knees non-stop for hours on end. And then in the loft, which was like the cruelest punishment.
You would have to scrub in 10, 15 minutes non-stop, and me being little had to be on tippy toe to actually reach the rafter and up there and scrubbing like this, and it just felt like my whole chest was being ripped right open, like my heart, like torn in two. You know, it was so cruel.
I just stubborn and determined not to give in, and one of the screws said to me, I can't break your spirit, but I sure as hell can break your heart.
The male officer that had always threatened me and always been a real problem, he was on duty. All the girls were in the rec room. And, you know, he just singled me out to embarrass me in front of my peers. And I retaliated. And as soon as he grabbed me by the hair and the scruff of the neck, I turned on him and it became a real fisticuffs. So I ended up here, and this was where I was actually raped. I had been sort of mauled before, but I'd fought off and yelled and screamed. But here I was actually drugged, and I just remember being in here as such a lonely person.
Then the real bad bashing, the worst one I got, when they brought me up here into segregation and kept me in here for almost a month, for the bruises to heal up. Because I was kicked, I was punched, I had my head pulled, I was smashed into the corner of the brick wall. I wasn't able to see anyone or speak to anyone for that period of time, and except for the officer on duty.
Crawford repeatedly bashed me, raped me orally, anally and vaginally.
I struggled and screamed and he hit me, his punches landing into my bare flesh, and he forced my legs apart.
After all these years, knowing that there's only a few of these perpetrators left, and to think that they have never been pulled up for any of the crimes that they've done, is just, it's a crime in itself.
I would love to see them squirming now, you know, and publicly, nationally humiliated for what they've done.
For many years I never talked about it, It was just shame, so much shame, because Parramatta, really, that was it. If you went to Parramatta, you were a bad girl. And I wasn't a bad girl. I was a lost child. I was an abused child. You know, and I ended up in here. And I got more abused.
There's a lot of marked graves and a lot of missing children from here. And this is a place where they can come and even mourn their lost ones.
Leaving something behind that is worthwhile and saying, well, you know, we had a part in that, making that a living memorial where people can come read and see what it's all what happened and learn from our past. Make sure it never happens again.